Greetings everyone, and welcome back to the online lecture series of microprocessor systems. This is the second lecture of this series, and in this lecture we are going to discuss about the interconnecting of registers, bus and memory transfer, and we'll try to design a simple RAM. So now we are in a position to start the design of different modules for our basic computer architecture. So first of all, let's discuss that why is it important to interconnect the different registers and different modules together, and how it's done effectively. So in a digital system, we need to transfer information from one module to another module, from one register to another register. Those registers can be general purpose registers or special function registers, and that flow of information requires that system to have some sort of connections, interconnections between those different modules, and those connections are nothing but the lines of wires that are connecting the inputs and outputs of different modules with each other. As there is no limit on which register can be connected to which module, so it's better that all the registers and all the modules have connection with all the rest of the modules and connections. So each register should be connected with every other register. But the problem arises with this ideal approach. To have a dedicated connection of every register with the other register, we require a huge number of connecting lines. For example, let's see that we have a 3-bit or a 4-bit register here, and we have another 4-bit register here, and we have, let's say, another 4-bit register here. So we have 3 4-bit registers. So connecting these two together, then these two together, and then these two together. So each register is connecting with the other one. So we have 3 registers and each register of 4 bits. And how many lines are there that are required to connect these 3 4-bit registers together? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, and 11, 12. 12 lines are required. And if each register is just 1 bit, then how many, or 2 bits, then how many lines will be required? 1, 2, and 3. So to connect 3 registers, we need 3 lines, but we should see that these lines are bidirectional. So effectively, double number of lines will be required to connect 2 registers, one for read and one for write. This means that to connect n registers, n-1 lines are required. To connect 3 registers, 6 lines are required, and these registers are just 1 bit. If each register is 4 bit wide, then multiply it by 4 further. So 24 lines will be required. These are just unidirectional lines that I said 12 lines are required. If we have bidirectional lines, so 2 lines required for one for read and one for write. Okay, so let's say that we have a 64 bit system and we have 4 giga registers. So let's just calculate that how many lines will be required to connect each register with every other register. 4 giga into 4 giga into 64. Just imagine how many lines will it become. So this is not a realistic approach to use separate wiring for each register in a large digital system. So we have to take a different approach that is practically realizable, where every register can be connected to the other register at will. So we are going to provide a path for each register to connect to the other. It is just like that you have some different houses and you have a main road. So these are your houses and you have this main road. So all the houses connect to the main road, and if you want to move from house number 1 to house number 3, you will just go to the main road, and from the main road you will come to the house 3. We don't need to connect each and every house together with each other through dedicated roads. We have a main highway for that purpose. And that highway in computer systems architecture is known as the bus. So the data will take the bus, and from the bus it can be transferred from any register to the other register. And we have control circuits to select which register is the source and which register is the destination. So in a physical world, in case of this example, that we have multiple buildings and a highway, smaller roads are already there. They are physically there, they exist. So each building is permanently connected to this main highway. But in case of data, there is an issue. If each register is permanently connected with a single bus, some register can be sending 1 and some register can be sending 0 to the same line, and it will create a short circuit. So we cannot permanently connect each register with a single bus permanently. And for that, what we do is we put some switches in between the registers and the bus, or we put some control mechanism between the registers and the bus, and at a time one of those registers is connected with the bus, and after the data has been transferred, the connection is then dropped. So it is the register is disconnected from the bus. So what are the approaches, what are the design level approaches that can be used to implement this bus-based system? Before going into that, now let me again emphasize on what we are doing here, which level of organization, architecture or design we are focusing on this point. So in computer architecture, we decided at architecture level that every register should have a capability to send or receive data from any other register. That was my architecture. That's what I wanted to do. Then at the organization level, I decided that I am not going to connect each and every register with each other with dedicated connection lines, but rather I am going to achieve that target set by the computer architecture level using a bus-based system. So that was computer organization. And moving further to the lowest level, the design level, now we are going to discuss that how are we going to implement that bus-based system, how are we going to design that control circuit, and how are we going to connect each register with the bus at will and then disconnect it after the data has been transferred. So the decision to use bus to achieve what we want was organization level, and in the next slide we are going to discuss at the design level. So let's see how the bus can be implemented, because there are multiple ways to implement that bus also. What's being done here is, this is a simple block diagram. Again, this slide can be considered as an organization level, because we have decided that there should be a bus and each register should be connected to that bus, and there should be some control circuit, maybe decoder based, maybe multiplexer based, that can select between one of those registers whose data has to be transferred to the bus. So the data of register R can be transferred to the bus. So again, I would say this is organization level. But when we are going into the actual component based details, then it would be design. So this is the bus implementation. the design of the bus, and we are implementing it using multiplexers. Let's first define what we want. We want the data of any of these four registers to travel to the bus. So we want to connect the output of these registers, one of these registers, to the bus. The rest of the three registers should not be connected to the bus. And when we select one register, all of its four bits should travel to the bus. So for simplicity, we are considering here four registers and each register of four bits. And remember, we are just right now trying to connect our registers output to the bus. So we are just trying to read the register. We are not going to write back to the register. We'll discuss that in the next slides. But for now, let's just try to read a register. To select between four registers, we need two select lines because 2 raised to power 2 is 4. And one register has to be selected altogether. All of its bits should be transferred to the bus. So we use a 4 cross 1 mux. This 4 is the number of registers because it defines our select lines. We want to select between how many number of registers? 4. So we use a 4 cross 1 mux. If it's a 1 bit register, we use just 1 mux. If it's a 2 bit register, we use 2 mux and common these select lines, these two select lines. So there will be still two select lines for the four registers, but both of the bits, the 0 bit and 1 bit, will be transferred to the bus at a time. And in case of 4 bits or n bit registers, we use n number of mux ICs. So what's happening here is, if we use 00, input number 0 of all the mux ICs will travel to the output of respective mux. And if we see here that the bit number 0, the input number 0 of all these mux is connected with the bits of register A. So each mux output is bit number 0, 1, 2, and 3 of the bus. For a 4-bit data, we need a 4-bit bus. So the whole register A is selected at a time and it travels through these four mux to the output of these mux to the bus. What if we want to write back to the registers? Can we use demux in that case? Yes, we can. But the issue will be that we'll have four select lines for four registers. Select lines are effectively the address of a register. At which address do you want to go? When you are traveling on a highway and there are multiple streets emerging from that highway connecting to different houses, you see at which address do you want to go and you just take that exit. So in case of computer architecture and data, the address represents a register. That which register do you want to connect to the bus? It's similar. So in case of one house, you can have just one address. You should have just one address. If there are multiple addresses, then that's not the ideal case. One address for each register. And to have one address for each register, you need to have two lines for four registers, 2 raised to power n lines for n registers. But if you have 2 into 2 raised to power n lines, then you will have two addresses for each register. So which one to follow? Human can understand, but a computer cannot. Computer is not intelligent. We have to tell the computer that go to that register, connect register X to the bus. So the computer will be confused whether to connect it using address 1 or address 2. So that would be an issue that arises when we are using mux and demux based implementation of bus. Secondly, there is another issue that the number of transistors and the number of mux devices required for this kind of bus implementation is very large. We can see here that we can multiplex k registers of n bits each to produce an n-line common bus. N-bit register means the defines the size of data and in turn defines the size of bus, and the number of multiplexers is equal to the number of registers. So the size of multiplexer is equal to, and the number of multiplexers is equal to the size of data, while the size of multiplexer will be dependent on the number of registers. So in summary, or the simplified rule is that the number of mux is equal to the number of bits, and the size of mux is dependent on the total number of registers. So this means that for a 64 bit 2 giga registers, we need 64 mux, and each mux of 2 giga size. This is the size of mux. So these are 2 giga inputs should be there in the mux, and we need 64 mux of the same specifications, and this is only for register reading. To write the register, multiply this whole number by 2 and replace the mux by dmux. So you are going to require 64 mux and 64 dmux, and each mux and dmux with 2 giga input lines. That is huge. So that is still better than the number of lines required to dedicatedly connect each register with the other one, but still this is huge. So there has to be a better way, and that is what we are going to explore in the next design. The next design is based on tri-state buffers. Now, what is a tri-state buffer? Tri-state. In logic design up till now, you have been familiar with two states, high or low, 1 or 0. But now we are going to discuss the third state, and that is Z, a high impedance state. So what is a high impedance? What is that state, and what is the significance of that stage? A tri-state buffer can have any one of these three states, 1, 0, or Z, high impedance. It is just like an electronic switch. Let me draw it here, a mechanical switch. If this switch is closed, this is the input and this is the output. If we have 0 at the input and the switch is closed, we'll have 0 at the output. If we have 1 at the input, we'll have 1 at the output. But if this switch is opened, what would happen? Regardless of what we have at the inputs, the output would be Z, would be high impedance, because this is a floating wire. It is not connected to anywhere. It is an open circuit. And what is the resistance or impedance of an open circuit? It is infinity. So that is why it is called a high impedance state. This is a very, very important concept, the high impedance concept, because it allows us to connect multiple outputs of tri-state buffers with each other. For instance, let's see, these are three tri-state buffers, three switches, and we are connecting the outputs of these switches together at one line of the bus. Here is 1, here is 0, here is 0. Now the inputs are different. Some of the switches have a 1 input as a data, some of them have 0 input, but their outputs are connected together without any issue, because all of these switches are open right now. If we just ensure that only one of these switches is closed at a time and the rest are open, only that 1 or 0 will travel to this bus line. The rest will not travel, will not be physically connected to the bus. So it will give us a huge advantage, and we are going to see it in the later design, that it will reduce the number of decoders that we are going to use. So we are going to use decoders for this case, because as we said, we want to ensure only one of these switches is on at a time, right? So decoder is a device that has only one output equal to one at any given instant, at any given combination of the select lines. A tri-state buffer is nothing else but an electronic switch. So there is an input, there is an output, and there is a control input. If that control signal is zero, it is an open switch. And if that control signal is one, it is a closed switch. So if it is a closed switch, the one will travel as it is, the zero will travel as it is, so two states. And if the switch is open, nothing will travel and it will be an open circuit, so a high impedance state. So let's see how we are going to design our bus practically at component level using tri-state buffers and decoders, and then we are going to use the same design for read as well as write, and we are going to ensure that only one address is there for each single register. So there are multiple advantages of this approach over the approach that we just discussed previously based on the MUX and DMUX. So this is the bus implementation using tri-state buffers. Let's assume you have four registers, just like in the previous case, A, B, C, and D. And for now, let's see that we have all the registers are just 1-bit registers. To select between any of the four registers, we need two select lines. We need a 2-bit address. So we use a 2x4 decoder. And these two select lines are the address of the register that we want to connect with our bus. For a 1-bit data, we need a 1-bit bus. And what we are doing here is, these are our registers, and we have connected the output of each register, via tri-state buffer to the bit number 0 of the bus. That is a single bit bus. So we have just one line bus for a 1-bit data. And all the registers must be connected with that same line. So we have connected physical or electronic switches between the output of each register and that single bus line. And we are going to turn on or off that electronic switch for that particular register based on our decoder. Whatever we give on our select inputs will select one of these switches, and that register will be connected to our bus. The rest will become open and will remain in high impedance state. So the data of A0 will travel to bus, while B0, C0 and D0 will remain open at 00 select input. But the beauty of this design can be explained if we have 2-bit registers, let's say. So we have a 2-line bus, 2-bit bus for a 2-bit data. So bit 0 of register A, B, C and D should be connected to bit 0 of the bus, and bit 1 of all these registers should be connected to bit 1 of the bus. No problem. We want to select one register, one full register at a time. So just use the same output of the decoder for register A, bit 1 tri-state buffer. We do not need to increase the size or number of this decoder. All we need to do is to add just one tri-state buffer to each bit of a register. And we have the bus design. For now, this is read. This is a read operation where we are just connecting the registers in one direction with the bus. So we can just transfer the data of register to the bus, not from the bus to the register, because the symbol of this buffer represents an arrow. So the data can flow only in one direction, in this direction of the arrow. This design, just for the read portion, is a huge advantage, because what we can see here is that for k number of registers, the size of decoder is k, k outputs. The size of the decoder should be k number of outputs. So in this case also, the size of decoder is being determined by the number of registers, similar to the size of mux being determined by the number of registers. But what happened in that case was, if we had n bit of data for each register, we needed n number of mux. But in this case, we need only one decoder for n bits of data. So for a 64-bit data, we need just one decoder, but 64 multiplexers. That is a huge advantage. And we are going to further elaborate it when we are going to implement the write operation as well. For the write operation, we needed the same size demultiplexers and 64 of them. But in this case, we will need just a dual decoder or a single decoder with twice the size of the number of registers. And that's it. That's a huge advantage in terms of hardware design to use the tri-state buffers instead of multiplexers and demultiplexers based design for bus implementation. So here is the general rule. For a common bus of k registers of n bit each, the size of the decoder will be determined by the number of registers, and the number of decoders will always be 1. There will be only one decoder for n bit of data to select between k registers. So let's now add the capability of write operation as well in this design. Alright, so we are going to implement the read and write both operations, and we are going to use a single bus for that purpose. So we'll have read lines, write lines, but both should be connected to the same bus because the highway is same. The highway is same. There is a single bus. Whether we want to read a data from a register, it should be put on the same bus, and whether we want to write a data to the register, it should travel through the same bus. So let's try that. For simplicity purpose, we are going to use two-bit registers. So here are two-bit registers. Bit number 0, 1, 0, 1. And let's call it register A and register B. Now, as we know that these registers are nothing but some combinations or a group of flip-flops. So this means that at the input side, the input is dependent on clock. The input will be written into the register through a clock signal, but the output of register is nothing else but a line. What is the output of a flip-flop? Where do you get the output of a flip-flop? There is no physical storage place inside that flip-flop. That when we say that the data has been stored, actually the state of that physical pin, that node, is retained unless changed otherwise, and that is what is called storing of a data. So that data is being stored at this line, at the output line. Whenever we want to read that data, we just read the state of this line, and that data remains stored at that particular node, and the state of that node will be retained. But the bus cannot store a data. The bus cannot retain its state. And that's why we want to use the bus only to transfer the data from one point to another point, but we cannot store data on the bus. So let's see how we do it. These are the register outputs, and let's say these are the register inputs. I'm not drawing the clock here for simplicity purpose. So to control which registers data has to be put onto the bus, and from the bus, the data has to be written into which register, we need to have full control over the read and write operation for both the registers. And to achieve that, what we do is we connect tri-state buffers at both the read and the write lines of these registers. So we have this circuit. Here are the 8 tri-state buffers, 2 for each bit of data, 1 for read and 1 for write. So as we have 2 bit of data, we'll have a 2 bit bus, bit number 0 and bit number 1, and this is our bus. So bit 0 of register A should be connected to bit 0 of the bus, and bit 1 with bit 1 of the bus, and same goes for the register B. And then same goes for the input side, the right side of these registers. If you see here, I am connecting the input side with the same bus. This is the same node. This one, this is a same node. This is a same node. Okay. So what's happening here? How to now control whether to read a register or to write a register and which register? For read operation, it was very simple. We saw that for two registers, we need a decoder that has two outputs and has just one select line. So output number 0 and output number 1. And let's denote it using blue lines. So for the register A, the control signals of register A, all the 2 bits are connected with bit number 0. And for the register B, all the control lines in green for register B are connected with bit 1. So if we have 0 at the select lines, we'll connect register A's output to the bus. So register A will be read. The data of register A will travel through these buffers to the bus. And if we have 1 at the select line, the data of register B will be read and will be transferred from the output of register B to the bus. Why can't we do the same thing for the register write? And in fact, we can. So what we are going to do here is we are going to have some additional control pins at the decoder. So 0, 1, 2, and 3. And now we have 4 decoder outputs. So we have 2 select lines, S0 and S1. But here comes the issue. We have a 2-bit address for 2 registers, but we should have a 1-bit address for 2 registers. The same issue that we discussed in case of mux and demux is repeating here. Not exactly. Let's draw the truth table for this one. So this is S0, this is S1, and this is the function being performed. So we have 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, and 1, 1. And the function in this case is read register A, read register B, write register A, and write register B. But if we see here, the good thing is that S1 remains same for read operation and remains same for write operation, while this one, the S0 represents the address 01AB01AB. So S0 is our address, while S1 is our read write. So this is our control bit. If it is 0, the register that has been selected by giving address through the second line will be read, and if it is 1, the register that has been selected by giving address at the other lines will be written. So this is our read write line, and this is our address line, and this cannot be realized in case of mux and demux. Why? Let me tell you here. Let's clarify it here. We have a mux. This is a mux. This is the, let's say it's a 2x4 mux. So we have 4 inputs and 1 output. So this is mux, and let's say this is a demux. So this, its input is 1 and there are 4 outputs, and again it has 2 select lines. So we can say this is the bus, and these are registers A, B, C, and D, and this is register A, B, C, and D. So if we select 0, 1 here, register B will be selected and it will come to the bus. And if we select 0, 1 here, the data from bus will travel to register B. So we have to give address at separate lines to read the register and separate lines to write the register. But what if we combine the bit 0 with bit 0 and bit 1 with bit 1 and give a 0, 1 there? So register B will be read at a time and written at a time. So both read and write operations will be performed at register B, and we don't want that. And there is no control. In this case, we have just 2 lines. So how are we going to control that? We can add further buffers, tri-state buffers at the input and the output. But again, the bottom line is that using mux and demux to implement the bus is not the better approach when we have this one using decoders and tri-state buffers. And it's a very efficient and seamless approach. We saw that we are getting a separate control line for read and write, to select between read and write operation. And we are getting separate lines to select between different addresses. We just want to use a demux, a decoder, twice the size of the number of registers. So if we have n number of registers, we need to have a decoder of 2n size. And that's it. A buffer at each input and each output of each bit of each register. And this is what is actually implemented inside a computer system architecture. Now, at this point, we are just talking about as if these registers are independent individual registers. They have their own identity, they have their own address, and the data from any of these registers can be transferred to or from the bus. So this is the main system bus. What is the main system? We have different modules, ALU, memory, RAM, etc. And this is our bus. So these are the registers of ALU, and these are the input-output registers, data register, program counter, and this is our bus. So this bus is moving through the whole system. And these are all special function registers. They have their own defined special functions. They are not just general purpose data storing register. They can perform some functions on the data as well, or they can store some special type of data. Both of these capabilities will render them special function registers. And they have their own control lines, like each register has a load pin, an increment pin, a clear pin, or some other pins as well. So to read a register, like to transfer the data from a register to the bus, the register is the source and bus is the destination. To read a register, we have to give address of that register, and that address is provided by the bus control. We want to put the data of which register on the bus is determined by the bus control circuit. But to write to a register, to transfer the data from bus to the register, only the load input of that particular individual register has to be given a 1. So to read a register, we have to give an address, and to write a register, we don't have to give an address, we just have to set the load pin of that individual register to one. But here, in this particular design, this is not happening. What we are doing is, to read a register or to write a register, we first give the address 0 or 1. And then from the main control circuit, we choose whether to read that register or write that register. So this means that this design, this particular design that we have discussed, is not for the special function registers, but it is for the whole memory. This is a more complicated design. For special function registers, we have a separate load pin for each register. So we don't need a decoder twice the size of the number of registers. We need it only in case of memory, because in a system, the memory is dealt as a unit. We deal it as a single unit. We want to read a memory or we want to write the memory. And the same thing happens in this case as well. So if we consider, let's say, this memory as a unit and we want to read the memory, we will consider memory as a single register. And we will select the memory using the bus, giving the address of memory itself, and selecting the memory's data to travel to the bus. But if we want to write to the memory, we will just say write to the memory, load of the memory should be sent with a signal 1. But when we say, okay, read from the memory or write to the memory, then we are just talking about memory as a unit, but we have to specify at which exact position inside the memory we want to write the data or we want to read from memory, and then inside the memory which register. So this design is for inside the memory, and this bus is also inside the memory now, and data from this bus inside the memory is transferred to the bus outside the system. This is the main bus. So we give an address of the memory separately using the bus and address inside the memory for the specific register through a separate address line, through memory addressing. So memory has address lines, same the bus has address lines. Bus will select the memory and the address lines of memory will select the register. And let's further clarify it using this SFRs and memory examples. So what we want to do here is, we want to transfer the data from an SFRB to SFRA using the main system bus. This is the main system bus. And we can see here that we do have the buffers, tri-state buffers, at each bit's input as well as at each bit's output. But the buffers at the input side are not connected to the decoder, but are connected to the individual load pins of that SFR. So the bus control will be used to read the register B, select it, enable these buffers of register B, and travel the data or transfer the data of register from register B to the main bus. And then the load of register A, individual load of register A, will be set 1 to 1, and the data will be traveling from bus to register A. So here, first of all, bus selection bit S will be 1, selecting B register, that is the source, and that will enable the buffers of, this will be 1, so these two buffers of the output of register B will be 1. So the data will travel from register B to the bus. And at the same time, load of A will be 1, and these two registers at the input of register A will be 1, and the data will travel from the bus into the register A. So this means that reading a register is an asynchronous operation and writing a register is a synchronous operation, and here a clock will also be required to load the data into register A. And in case of memory, this is the design that we discussed. So let's just ignore this portion. We have already discussed it. So this is now the 2-bit internal memory bus, and this is now the 2-bit main external bus. And now these two are connected through buffers as well. So now just consider this 2-bit bus as an SFR, as a register. So when you are selecting this 2-bit bus, you are selecting the memory, the SFR, the memory unit. And when the memory is source, when we are reading from the memory, it is selected by the main bus control. And when we are writing to the memory, it should be done by sending a signal to the memory write. So we are shorting out, combining the node of memory write here and here, the decoder select bit. So this is a simple RAM design. There is a read-write control. There is an address bus to select between which register inside the memory has to be selected. There is a data bus that is inside the RAM. And then this bus, this portion of bus, should not be bulging out of this blue box, as this blue box is representing the RAM. And there should be some connection here, and then that should be connected with the bus. The bus itself is not coming out. Yes, the connection from the bus is coming out. So it's one way to represent it, but I would prefer that a separate connection from the bus inside the memory should be connected to the bus outside the memory. So these two connections are outside, coming outside the box for data transfer. Some control signals, read-write control, is coming out of the bus, and an address bus is coming out of the memory. So this is a simple RAM design, and it is represented like this. We have already discussed this one, so no need to go into the details of this slide. And RAM calculation, I think the audience should be aware at this point that in computer systems, the kilo, mega, giga, tera is not just 10 raised to power 3, 10 raised to power 6, but rather 2 raised to power 10, 2 raised to power 20, and so on. So yes, this is an important common bus system, as I was discussing in the previous few slides. We have some special function registers that have a two-way connection with the bus, like the address register, program counter, data register, accumulator, instruction register, and so on. And each of these registers have their own load pin. See here also. While the address of these registers to read them is provided by the S0, S1, and S2, that is the bus control. And we can see here that we have 8 units. This is, I think, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and so total number of combinations is 8, and to select between 8 registers, we need 3 select lines. And here we can see that at number 7, the memory is connected. So the memory is read by giving S0, S1, S2 a value of 1, 1, and 1. So this 7 number is selected, and the memory is connected as a whole to the bus. But which register inside the memory is connected to the inside bus and then to the outside bus, that is determined by these address lines, and that is coming from the address register. And then we have a read-write control. So this is a common bus system that we are going to discuss and implement in this course. So far, we have discussed the structure of individual registers. So this part has been done. We have implemented a main common bus system. So this part has been done. And we have implemented the memory. So this part has been done. And next we are going to move to the ALU, the arithmetic logic unit or the central processing unit. And after the hardware implementation of ALU, the next thing we are going to discuss about is the instruction set and how the instructions are executed. So before going to the arithmetic logic unit, let's summarize the transfer micro operations, where only the data transfer is occurring, but no other operation is being performed on the data. Data of register B is transferred to A, data of data register is transferred to address register, some constant is transferred to a register, the data from register is transferred to bus, and bus is transferred to the other register, and so on. So these are the transfer micro operations. The only thing to note from this summary is this point, that when we talk about memory as a unit, the address inside the memory is determined by the square brackets. So M represents memory, and inside this is the address inside that memory, that which register inside that memory we are talking about. And that address is always coming from the address register AR or memory address register MAR. We use these two terms interchangeably. So at this point, we have completely covered the transfer micro operations and transfer of data in through hardware from one point to another point, from the memory also and between the special function registers also. And next, we are going to implement the ALU. So for this lecture, that's it. We have completed the transfer operations. So I hope you will have gained some knowledge about how the data is being transferred inside the processor. So up till the next lecture, take care, stay safe, goodbye.